Hello, everybody, and welcome to the June 12th Trips and Traps. Andy Serling, joined by Richard Migliori.
I'm excited because this is the first Trips and Traps that I've been involved in. We actually have a dirt race to talk about.
Yeah, there was a pretty interesting dirt race on Sunday we're looking to talk about, but the other three will be turf races, and we'll start with a couple of races from the day before the Belmont Stakes on June 6th. And the first horse we want to look at is a first-time star, Richie, named Celtic Sunrise, who ultimately finished third.
Yeah, and she ran extremely well. We both agree. She looks like a nice filly. She broke okay, and then she gets jammed a little bit up out of that inner turf chute. And you can see her. She's number seven.
She's right there.
Right there. And you're going to see in a moment, she's going to kind of get jammed back to last as the horses come together right there. And not that she checked. She almost checked herself because she realized she was in trouble. Got out of the spot. And now she's last. And she's a pretty good ways from the lead.
Yeah, we were talking about it, maybe as much as a dozen lengths out of lead. I think this is a very good example, as you see her back in last, of how a very relatively minor amount of trouble can be dramatically exaggerated, especially in turf races at the start.
Well, and especially out of that inner turf, you know, it's a little bit of a funny configuration. She's a first-time starter, so she's not completely clued into what's going to take place, the proceeding, so to speak. But you can see now she kind of creeps up towards the inside, and she gets back in the race. Now, this pace was extremely slow, and her to have to make up all that ground in the middle of the race, I mean, she winds up in position, but at what cost?
Right. Now, this was a very tepid pace in a race where the whole pace held together in here. And I thought she ran extremely well. And she also, Richie, it seems like she's kind of doing it on his own. And Rod lets her run a little, but she's running in a very sort of smooth manner to get herself into the race.
She really did. And even though it didn't help her on this day, ultimately, I think this is the kind of race that a horse builds on. This is the kind of race that helps a horse for a career, not so much for one race.
Right. I mean, obviously, you want to win when you run them, but this was a good education race. And the winner of the race, Lady Creese, is actually okay. I think Celtic Sunrise is a better horse and the best horse in this race. You know, you can argue that a lot of things went right after the start, but that start affected her so dramatically that she had way too much to do, and also a lot of good education coming through on the inside and tight.
Well, to have a horse first time in a big field of horses to run this well, she saved all the ground. Of course, that's great. Turf racing, you got to save ground. But then for her to come through inside of pretty tight quarters without any hesitation, this speaks of a quality about her and a courage about her that's going to bode very well. And she's the only horse really, really running from back in the pack.
Yeah, I mean, this is kind of, I like races like this where you find there's one horse that sort of ran against the dynamics of the race, because the dynamics of the race favored horses up front, and also nobody really changed their positions. She had trouble early, and she was the only one running at the end. I think Celtic Sunrise, horse for Christophe Clement, is going to go on and break her maiden and also turn out to be okay.
Yeah, I think she has a future.
Yeah, I agree as well. Turning our attention to the eighth race. Now, this is a horse we're not exactly sure what to do with Casa Creek going forward, but we certainly know, and Richie has some interesting thoughts, that Casa Creek had a significant amount of trouble, as we'll show the pan first down the backstretch. This is the horse in gold with the purple cap. You'll notice this horse because it's setting the entire way down the backstretch.
Yeah, and she really kind of gets shuffled out. She seems to overreact to everything that Gary Stevens wants to do with her. She was a little keen. She wound up on top of horses on the inside. Maybe she was trying to get out a little bit. She might have been better off just dropping her head and letting her run, Andy.
Well, it'll be interesting to see. When you watch these races, now, I have a question for you. As we're going to show it again, you can see her. She's between horses, and Gary's almost standing up on her right here. I'm going to try to stop it, and there she is, yellow with the purple hat again. Let's say you're still riding, Richie, and you get the mount on this horse. I mean, it has to be a necessity as a rider to watch the replay of the last race the horse ran, being that you've never been on her.
Well, absolutely. And the one thing that I took when we watched the head-on, she kind of slipped behind. So Gary kind of squeezed her to go forward after she slipped. And maybe that's a mistake with this filly, because you can see she's just about out of control here. She's getting shuffled back again. When everybody else is going forward, she's going backwards. Basically, the race is over for her at this point. If I was in that position and I knew the filly and I was going to ride her back, I'd want to break as quiet as I could, but I wouldn't get in her mouth. I'd just let her do whatever she was going to do naturally, and hopefully she would switch off enough where she just didn't run off to the lead because she looked like, I'm sorry, he. That, well, you know, and it's interesting because I kept losing sight of this when I watched the replay earlier, because most of the time you get fillies that'll flip their head around like that. And not colts. Colts are, you know, they're much heavier headed, and they'll pull into the bridle and drop their head more. And this horse was really, maybe this horse just has a very bad mouth.
Well, you know, it's interesting. Look, Gary obviously just gave up the stretch. I mean, he tried a little bit, but he knew he had no chance from the position that he was in. Here's what you're talking about. The horse is almost climbing, right?
Yeah, the horse is climbing, switched leads already a couple of times, just switched back to right. Now he's going to get on top of the horse inside of him. Now, is it because he's trying to avoid the heels to the outside horse? There seems like there's space in between. This looks like a very difficult horse. horse to ride, a difficult horse to manage. And again, I think in, if you have the room, now he's had a run out of options. But if you have the room, allow a horse like this to run freely, because you're not going to get anything fighting with a horse like this.
But this is probably the kind of horse, if it gets good position and gets towards the front, maybe a race with not a lot of speed and can either be first or second early in the clear, could be a completely different animal.
Well, absolutely. You're not going to be using all that energy going backwards and up and down, and you're going to have some continuity into the horse's stride.
Well, that's an interesting horse going forward, and I'm definitely interested in Castle Creek because the horse has prior form that I think is good enough. We will go to Sunday's card, June 8th, and take a look at the first dirt race, Richie, that we'll be talking on Trips and Traps.
Yeah, and Mike Smith on Susie Malibu, a horse that you and I had talked about, broker maiden at Santa Anita, he's going to kind of get shuffled back a little bit early. You're going to see Mike's going to have to take up as the eight horse kind of crosses over. And I thought it was a little bit maybe over-dramatized here. I mean, it didn't seem like it was as bad as we're going to see Mike react to this horse crossing over. It seemed like maybe he could have got out of the spot a little bit smoother. And you see there, okay, now he kind of has to sit down on her and ride her again. But this leads to just a terrible trip, having to now make your run wide with pressure from the outside. The only thing being worse than wide is being wide and in between.
Yeah, I agree, especially when you're trying to get your momentum and trying to rally. And I mean, this is a horse that had trouble last time in its debut and was very impressive visually, but met a very slow field. Now you've got the horse outside of her. The question is, see, I think, we talked about this beforehand, and I think that you ultimately agree. I think that Mike had the hole with this horse. The other horse is just going faster than her, and I'm not sure that Susie Malibu could keep up when the running started.
Well, I think there was some race riding going on, too, and it's hard to ascertain if there was a lot of body contact and slowed her down from continuing that forward progress, but she just was in no position to win at that point. And she actually did good to run on for third, because right here now she's back in behind horses after being outside horse in the turn. She could have given up, and she actually kind of, you know, pecked along for a minor share.
No, in fact, Richie, that's exactly what I liked about her performance, the fact that she didn't give up, and that once she got herself a little bit of daylight towards the end, she came running again. It was a race that the winner is a nice horse, first of all. The winner of this race, West Coast Chick, we'll see in stakes at Saratoga, no doubt. She was broke a step slow, and she wired the field. So the race was controlled in the front end, probably by the best horse, but controlled in the front end nonetheless, and she was forced to make that move, had the horse outside of her, momentum. They, not only when they were, when she was coming the outside, but also the field drifted a little bit inside of her, and that took away her position as well. But she was never completely discouraged.
No, and again, that she continued on. I believe she was second best in this race. I like the winner, West Coast Chick. I agree with you. I think she's a nice filly, and she has a future. But Susie Malibu probably would have been second. And obviously, in that condition, West Coast Chick's not going to be there next time.
No, I agree. And she's a horse that I think was a little overrated because she had such an exciting, explosive maiden victory in what was a bit of a slow race, all things considered. But she's still an okay horse, and you don't want to just sort of dismiss her because she disappointed some people in that race. We have one more race to look at, and this is the Intercontinental Race 8 from Sunday, June 8th card. And Richie and I want to talk about a couple of horses, the 5 Assateague and the 2 Baffle Me. Both of them had trips.
Yeah, they both had tale of two kind of trips. I mean,
there's Assateague and there's Baffle Me.
Yeah, Assateague actually goes forward enough to secure her position in the pocket. Good turf trip in that respect. Baffle Me was always kind of in no man's land, never really secured a comfortable position, kind of always in between, not really owning her own path, and I think it led to her trouble.
Yeah, no, I agree. You know, we were talking about it, watching it live, Baffle Me gets caught in that position where she never has any options, Richie, and as a rider in these situations, you need to have options.
Well, I think you've always seen your best riders try to have as many options as possible. Jerry Bailey was great at having 2, 3, maybe even 4 options. We saw Johnny Velasquez on Palace Malice making sure he had about 3 options. That's what you want to do. And you can kind of see here, he has 1 option, and that's to kind of wait and eventually try to follow the winner, but he has no momentum. So it's hard to accelerate when other horses are getting first run on you. Assateague here sitting a good trip at this point.
Yeah, Assateague's down on the inside, and we'll get to that. But the winner, who's 3 wide there, also knows Baffle Me is inside of her and knows that she's one of the horses to beat in here, so there's no way that she's letting Baffle Me out. Assateague tries to get out, and we'll see it better, I think, on the head-on when we talk about it. She's ultimately not comfortable when she gets forced to go back inside.
No, and she tried to come out and split, and Joel Rosario was also aware that she was there and was like, no, you're not getting out of here. I'm closing this door and keeping it closed. And she tried. She was, Luis Saez on her Azteca was very persistent trying to get that spot and eventually had to go back to the rail where there was room, but now the race is essentially over.
Yeah, and Baffle Me was getting bumped around and never able to get in a position. And this is not the first time we've seen Joel do a very good job of riding other horses in the race. Now, Azteca is down on the inside. Baffle Me is back there with a lighter blue cap. And you can watch both of them. You'll see, as Azteca guys to go between horses and Joel says, no, you're going to see Baffle Me gets about a split second of room. But after that, ducks in and gets badly buffeted between horses.
Oh, yeah, she really get buffeted about. And, this is one of those things you got to go back and watch this head on twice because you're trying to keep your eye on two different horses. Now, you can see Azteca now has gotten back to the fence, but with no momentum, and the race is basically over. Great race riding in two different spots by Joel Rosario. And Baffle Me, I think, took the worst of it, much worse than Azteca, because of that buffeting about. She had no opportunity to gain her rhythm and go forward.
Yeah, and I think a lot of people focused more on Azteca's trip than they did Baffle Me's, and Baffle Me be the one who never had a chance. Now, Azteca ran okay, too.
Sure.
With an easier situation, she could have won. And I agree about Joel. It reminds me of his imagining ride when he won the Man of War, when he rode Grandeur down the inside, he rode Real Solution the outside. I mean, this is stuff that I look back and I remember Cordero doing this brilliantly.
Yeah, and absolutely. And Joel does it so subtly that it's not like this big demonstrative thing. He just kind of laid him back in there and had enough horse. And I guess coming off the day he had Belmont Day, it's easy to be that confident that, well, I'm going to get the leader. Let me just make sure I keep these guys pinned down.
Well, it's a question of understanding not just your horse, but who the horses you have to deal with. And legally, riding the other horses to your advantage. Once again, we can always use your help as well. It's Trips and Traps at NYRINC.com.